Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship this morning. Good morning, Mark. Hope you're continuing to do well. We're going to start things off with a song. The first one is Jesus in Disguise.
In your head, it's nothing you've heard or something you've read. Ever had a cut but you never saw the blade, brought to your knees but you never prayed. Jesus in disguise, to hold a passing by, the burden of a tear hanging in your eyes. Jesus in disguise, a scar across the sky. You were looking for a king we would never recognize. Jesus in disguise. You ever feel like you've been somewhere before? You hold the key.
Today and good to have you with us. We're in this time of transition and it's wonderful to have people in the room again and to know that I'll be looking both at the camera and at people who are here around me. It's amazing. It's absolutely amazing. And I give thanks as we continue to move forward as we get through and beyond eventually a pandemic. If you're taking part on Facebook today, I invite you to make some comments and greet each other and say where you're worshiping from today. Thanks for being present. Go ahead and make comments. And as I said, today we continue our gradual return to in-person worship. Today is the first Sunday where we've opened up to a maximum of 50 people in attendance for each of our worship services. Continue to keep an eye on Thursday's e-news so that you can be ready for what's coming and also be aware of how you can participate. Remember that Lisa needs to hear from you by end of office business hours on Wednesday at 5 p.m. And then our council meets again on May 10th to consider any new regathering limits and protocols that are emerging. We will celebrate communion today, and those who are in the room have communion to be taken at their seats. And I invite you at home or wherever you are to get some wine or juice and some bread ready so you can participate later in the service. I've got mine here ready to go. A couple other quick reminders. Pastor Emily's new Bible study is on the letters of Paul, and it's in its early stages. And you are always welcome to hop in whenever you can make it. The Bible study meets outside on Thursday mornings, weather permitting, here on the church campus, and by Zoom on Thursday evenings. So see the e-news for all the details. Also, mark your calendars now for May 23rd, that afternoon. That'll be our next drive-through communion event, and we're hoping to have some other things going on that day as well. But just mark the calendar that afternoon, and we'll have more details coming as early as this Thursday's e-news. That's going to be afternoon of May 23rd, 3 weeks from today. Well, as we gather today for worship, I've got a quote for us to ponder and reflect on as we begin our worship. This is from Mechthilde of Magdeburg, a 13th century leader in the church who did a lot of writing, and she was a very prayerful person. She was a leader in the church and kind of spoke out about the relationship with God and how sometimes the institutional church interferes with that relationship in some ways. And so she made us very aware of our residing in God's heart as often and as best we can. So consider this quote as we begin this morning. The soul is made of love and must ever strive to return to love. Therefore, it can never find rest nor happiness in other things. It must lose itself in love. By its very nature, it must seek God, who is love. Certainly, we can see in this quote the life that Jesus embodied and the life he was striving to pass along to his followers as well. That nature of love being our true nature, who we are deep down, and what the world truly needs. We'll talk a little bit more about that later on in our worship service. For now, let's begin with prayer. Good and gracious God, gathered here today, we are a people who always need reminding that your nature is love and it's our nature too. That we are created in your image, not only to receive the good news of your grace, but also to embody it and share it. So we pray as we worship today that your love might be present in our room, in our world, in our hearts, in our minds, and in our time together, so that you might make the most of our willingness to serve and to love as we leave this time together. We thank you, God. It is always in your peace, your promises, and your presence that we pray. Amen. Let's join together and sing our next song, shall we?
Our next song is Hold On to Me.
When the best of me is barely breathing, when I'm not somebody I believe in, hold on to me. When I miss the light, night is stolen, when I'm slamming all the doors you've opened, hold on to me. I could rest here in your arms forever. 'Cause I know nobody loves me better. Hold on to me. Hold on to me.
That was beautiful. Thank you, folks. Thank you. Thank you. Well, it's time for our children's message, and I'm thankful we've got some kids in the house today, which is wonderful, and I invite those of you at home to get a little closer. As Pastor Emily says, push the adults out of the way for a moment and take front and center around your screen so we can spend some time together. And so glad that we're able to see each other in the same room again on occasion, and it's good to have you here. So I've got a question for you today. And it's a little bit of a goofy question. It might even sound like the beginning of a really bad joke, but the question goes like this. It is, what does following Jesus have to do with growing grapes? Have you ever thought of that? What does following Jesus have to do with growing grapes? Well, all right, let's talk about that a little bit. It sounds kind of funny, but in our Bible reading today, Jesus paints a word picture for us using the idea of grapes growing on a vine. Maybe you want to look up pictures of that, but grapes hanging on a vine. Jesus says to his followers, he says this, I am the grapevine, you are the branches, and God is the vine grower. Think about that. Jesus saying, I'm a grapevine, you are branches, and my Father, God, is the vine grower. And we are here to grow something, not grapes, but what? Love, right? Yeah, we're here to grow love. That's kind of why we do this thing called church and why we follow Jesus. Then in order to do that, he uses a word that we don't hear very often. And that word is abide. A-B-I-D-E, abide. Now that sounds a little bit like abode. Some people talk about their house or their home as their abode, where they live, and that's what Jesus is talking about. So what does it mean when we talk about abiding as some place where we live, and then Jesus is talking about this is what we're supposed to think about, where we truly live all the time. Now, some of us live in a house. Y'all live in a house? Some of us might have a townhome. Some of us might have an apartment. Some of us might even have a hotel or a condo. There are lots of different places we can abide, places we live, but that's not what Jesus is talking about. And Jesus says something very different about this word abide. Jesus says, in order to be his followers and to share his work, to do his work, we need to abide in his love. Abide in his love. In other words, we're to make his love our home. Okay? That's what I'd like you to talk about this week with your families. What are some ways that we can abide in God's love or Jesus' love and his message to us and to the world? How do you make love like your house that you always live in? We could probably think of ways to do that, and some of which are connected to life together in church, right? Like being here for worship today and participating in worship today is a way we abide in God's love. Every week when we worship, we hear a message of how much God loves us, and then we've got work to do to help share God's love with others. So that's one way we kind of make God's love our house that we live in. And what are some other ways? Well, reading Bible stories, like this one this morning. And praying. Praying is another word to help us abide. And maybe finding someone to help. I know you folks have done things to help hungry people in our neighborhood and communities. And whenever we help someone, we're abiding in God's love. Feeding someone who is hungry, or just helping your parents or your siblings around the house, or someone who is a friend of yours who's hurt or lonely and needs a friend. These are ways, lots of ways we abide. All of these things are ways we can abide in love and make love the place we live, the way we live more often. And one day, maybe one day this fall, we'll be able to gather together for faith formation again, hopefully soon, when we can get together in our groups on Sunday morning. And I'm hoping that day isn't too far away. Jesus says the way to help him share God's love is to find ways to abide in his love. Talk about that as a family this week. I've got another story a little bit later that'll help us continue to work on that and see how many ways you can figure out how to abide in God's love. Let's pray. God, we thank you for Jesus who loves us. We thank you for his message of love. And we know that love truly does make our life worthwhile. Help us to understand that as we abide in that love and find ways to do it, that we've got more to share because your love is never ending, an endless supply. And for that, we thank you. Amen. Thanks for sharing some special time this morning. I appreciate that. And we'll continue to work toward a time when we can all be together while we do that. Our reading for this morning is John chapter 15. Jesus is speaking to his followers. He says, "I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower. He removes every branch in me that bears no fruit. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes to make it bear more fruit. You have already been pruned by the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered, thrown into the fire and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love." We've been reading through the gospel according to John for these weeks after Easter. And as part of this gospel, John's Jesus, who looks and talks differently than Matthew, Mark, and Luke's Jesus, but John's Jesus has been making five very picturesque statements about himself. Using these five I am statements. I am, Jesus says, and he tells his followers, I am the bread of life. I am light of the world. I am the gate for the sheep. And as we talked about last week, I am the good shepherd for the sheep. And today Jesus continues that with one more metaphor or image, and it's, I am the vine, you are the branches, and God is the vine grower. He uses this parable or this metaphor of grapevines to talk about our relationship to God and our relationship with him. Jesus is the vine, we are the branches, and God is a vine grower. Now, one of the first things he mentions, which I talked about in the Faith Lift on Thursday, is pruning. There's pruning to be done. Pruning helps vines produce more fruit, and the fruit Jesus talks about us producing is love. But we want to notice and pay attention to who does the pruning. That's very important. It's so very important because the pruning is left up to God. In other words, as branches of the vine, we don't do any of that pruning of other branches ourselves. Maybe we can look at our own work and production and vine and grape growing, if you will, and allow that pruning to happen in our lives. But we're not responsible for pruning other branches on the vine. Apparently, that's not our best skill set. Okay? You and I know we'd love to do some pruning among the other branches in the Jesus vine as we understand it in our world. But God knows better than we do. And in fact, Jesus is the vine, and Jesus doesn't even do any pruning. So if Jesus doesn't get to prune other branches of the vine, then neither do we have to worry about that. We are only, like Jesus, trying to find ways to grow and produce the fruit of God's love, as best we can. We know pruning the other branches on our vine is nothing we have to worry about. So according to John's picture of Jesus here, what's a branch to do? What is our task as branches of the vine? What can we do in order to produce more fruit and more love in the world and in our lives? And that's where the word comes in again, abide. Abide. Our attention is to be intentional about abiding as we go about life. Abide. The most important thing branches can do to produce the best and the most fruit that the vine grower needs and the vine needs is to abide in Christ, and more specifically, to abide in His love. From time to time, and I think you kids will appreciate this, from time to time I talk about our dog, Tessa. Tessa is 7 pounds, a furry little ball of lots of love and joy and energy. And Tessa is a Yorkshire Terrier, and she's a rescue, all right? We rescued her because she was given up by another family at some point, and we don't know all the specifics about that, but she's almost 9 years old, between 9 and 10, and we've had her for about 4 years now. Now, Tessa, being a rescue, has been abandoned before, and every time that Cindy or I or both of us get ready to leave the house, guess what she does? She starts whining and crying and shaking like crazy. You can visibly just watch her and she's shaking like this constantly. So Tessa doesn't like it at all when we leave the house, to say the least. She's definitely got separation anxiety and would prefer that we never leave the house at all, right? No matter how many times we leave and come back, she still shakes and cries every time we even start to get ready to leave the house. She knows it. She can tell. She can feel it. And of course, when we finally do come home, whether it's been 10 hours or 10 minutes, you would think it was the best thing that ever happened, right? She jumps up and down constantly. She is desperate for us to pet her and to love her. And she wants to show her love for us, dancing with joy and trying to lick us like we're a puppy dog lollipop. You know, that's just the most amazing thing when we get welcomed home. Well, why am I telling you about Tessa, our dog? It's because she loves to abide. She loves to abide. No matter where we are in the house, she wants to be in that room with us. No matter where we are. And what drives her crazy is when Cindy and I are in two different rooms in the house, and she's got to go back and forth, and she plops down in the middle and makes sure she can hear both of us, and every once in a while she'll check on both of us, right? But she keeps going back and forth, and then, you know, she loves it when we're together, and then if we both get on the couch, boom, she's right there with us. You know how that is, right? She loves to abide. And when we finally do sit down, she'll hop up next to us and she'll want to sit in our lap. That's her favorite thing to do. And if she can't sit in our lap, then she'll lay down right up against us, okay? Even at night, she loves to sleep with us in the bed. And of course, she wants to be in contact with us while we do that. She won't settle to sleep until she nudges up against one of us. Now, when Jesus talks about abiding in his love or abiding in God's love, he's talking about finding ways to remain close, to live in the constant awareness of God's loving embrace, and to maintain contact as if our life depended on it. Tessa is an excellent reminder. My dog Tessa is an excellent reminder of what helps us produce more and more love in our lives. It is to stay in contact with the love of God in a way that is most meaningful and most helpful for us. Stay in contact. To abide in God's love on a regular basis. So how do we do that? I imagine we will all have different ways of answering that question. I mentioned some of them during the children's message, didn't I? You know, things like prayer and reading the Bible and Bible stories and other things like that. But we worship being a part of the ways we're inspired and reminded of God's love in our lives. Prayer and meditation are a way to do that. Study of the Bible and helps us abide. Conversations with other people of faith are essential to abiding in God's love. Listening to inspirational music can help us abide, along with spending time out in the natural world, out in creation, where we get fed and nurtured by the presence of God in the beautiful world, especially this time of year when everything is literally springing back to life. And spending time with people who love us, along with our pet friends like Tessa and others who can help us remember what it means to abide. Basically, anything that helps us remember we are loved and that grace is the primary energy in our lives. Unconditional regard and love. I remember reading a suggestion by author and Franciscan priest Richard Rohr, who I've talked about often and read many of his books. Several years ago, he talked about a practice that helps, and it's easy to do and it's quick to do. And that is a quick prayer of intention every morning. Every morning, whether you're waking up and getting out of bed or heading out the door, to just a 5-second prayer that goes something like this. God, help me to be the most loving person I can be today. Help me to be the kind of person you want me to be today. Or something like, Lord, help me to be aware and show me your grace in the world as I go about my day. Because we all know we have days that are filled with things contrary to love and grace, to say the least. And then secondly, at the end of the day, sometime before you fall asleep, and even as a way, instead of counting sheep, make your gratitude list. Express some gratitude and be thankful for the ways in which you've encountered blessing and grace and love during that daily journey. In what ways did you experience grace in simple ways, like whether it's a dog leaping when you get home, or a meal you ate, or someone who served you in some capacity in the world around you with a simple transaction or need? Make that list of ways in which grace impacted your life as you drift off to sleep. It's a small way to begin each day and then to end each day with a moment of abiding, to remember why we are here, to be loved and to love. And it's that simple and it's that profound and essential to enjoying the life we get to live. I'd like to conclude with two quotes here from Mechthild of Magdeburg, who I mentioned earlier. She was a church leader and teacher in Germany during the 13th century. And she focused her attention on something that had been forgotten often in her world and her time, which was this relationship with God who lives within us, not just out there, but in here. One of the things she said is, a fish cannot drown in water, a bird does not fall in air. In the fire of creation, God doesn't vanish, the fire brightens. Each creature God made must live in its one true nature. How could I resist my nature that lives for oneness with God? The nature that is within us is love. The source that brought us into being is love. And the energy that makes my heart beat and my lungs breathe is love. Oneness with God, who is love, is our true self. Just like water for fish and air for birds, it's our place to abide and to thrive. Not a place, mind you, but a condition and a state of being. Last thing is what we started with in our centering time. The soul is made of love and must ever strive to return to love. Therefore, it can never find rest nor happiness in other things. It must lose itself in love. By its very nature, it must seek God, who is love. So Jesus is the vine in God's vineyard, and we are the branches. May we remember that our very soul is made of love, and for the purpose of producing fruit that is love, as we find our rest and our joy in the ways we abide. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our next song is Maybe It's Okay.
If I didn't know what it hurt like to be broken, then how would I know what it feels like to be whole? If I didn't know what it cuts like to be rejected, then I wouldn't know the joy of coming home. And maybe it's okay if I'm not okay, 'cause the one who holds the world is holding on to me. And maybe it's alright if I'm not alright, 'cause the one who holds the stars is holding my whole life. If I didn't know what it looked like to be dirty, your will be done here in my heart as in heaven. Father, let your kingdom come. Let your will be done here in my heart as in heaven. Maybe it's okay if I'm not okay.
okay if I'm not okay.
Took my mask off there for a moment. Apologize for that. Get a sip of water. As we move through our service, it's a time when we usually receive our offering. And I just want to say thank you for everyone who's continued to be generous so that we can continue to do what we're doing, both here in this place, but also in the community, in the world. And along those lines, May 23rd, you'll get information and details this coming Thursday, but we're going to be collecting food for the family shelter that they serve to families who are staying there. These are homeless families that are in transition and trying to get back on their feet here as our local neighbors. So as they deal with homelessness, they have the benefit of knowing that people like us care. So on May 23rd, we'll be collecting food for the meals they provide at the shelter, and a list of those most needed foods will be in Thursday's e-news. So thank you for continuing to be generous and help those who need God's love as we abide not only with God, but with them. For our prayers today, you'll see that, and the response is on the screen. Lord of the journey, show us the way. Let us pray. O God, whose very nature is love, help us to remember that we are created in your image. Remind us daily that we are born from love in order to embody love, a love that brings hope and healing to your world. Lord, help us as we strive to make that love our home, as we seek ways and make time to abide in you, in love. Lord of the journey,
show us the way.
Almighty God, we pray that in times of division and misunderstanding, we will be known by how well we love one another. Give us patience and a yearning for understanding as we work to move toward harmony and unity through listening deeply, through recognizing that we are different and that's okay, and through gratitude for the sheer diversity of your creation, including the one beautiful human family. Lord of the journey,
Show us the way.
As we slowly move into life with a pandemic and begin to hope and dream of a world and of our lives beyond a pandemic, please guide us as we continue to be wise, to do whatever we can to keep those who are most vulnerable safe, and to make sure that everyone who needs and wants to have preventative measures in their life has that opportunity. And as our ideas about returning to a more active and social life differ, help us all to be patient with one another and to offer one another the grace and respect with which you regard us. We continue to pray for those areas of the world that are reeling right now with surges and COVID cases, even as we feel some sense of relief that perhaps in this nation, the worst may be behind us. Thank you, God, for your healing love and all the people who make that possible, all the people who embody that as we continue to move through this unusual time and seek to not only receive but share your blessing. Lord of the journey,
show us the way.
Gracious God, we are mindful of people that we wish to pray for this morning. We thank you for loved ones who have recently died, including Grace and Ralph. May you continue to surround their friends and family with the healing, comfort, and love of your presence and your promises that are even stronger than death. And gracious God, we pray for others whose needs are known to us as we lift them before you, including Christine, Rachel, Howard, B, Melissa, Charlene, Donald, Mary Beth, Elizabeth, Tim, Eloise, Dot, Daniel, Chris, Levi, Liam, Danielle, Deanna, Helen, Sam, Emily, Elijah, Ron, Jane, Mark, and Terry. Lord, there are other people that need your comfort, your healing, and your love in their lives, and we take a moment to name them now before you, either silently or out loud. In all things, God, may we trust you, and may we know that not only are you present for us, but somehow as we offer ourselves to each other in love, that you are present within us as well. Lord of the journey, show us the way. All these things we pray, trusting that Jesus is the vine, that we are the branches, and that your desire is to help us grow and produce love for the world. And so we pray as Jesus taught his first followers. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
I invite you to prepare for communion. Get your bread and wine or juice ready to share in just a moment, and join with me in the words of welcome to communion this day. We call this meal by many names, one of them being Holy Communion. Like prayer, this sacrament is a way we commune with God and abide in God's love. Like conversation with friends, this meal is a way we commune with one another and share our common life, grounded in grace and rooted in the love of God. Aware of God's constant loving presence, we live for the purpose of love. Thankful for one another, we find strength for the journey with Christ as people of compassion. Let's remember together. While Jesus and his followers were sharing the Passover meal, he took bread and gave thanks, praying, "Blessed are you, Lord our God, creator of the universe, who brings forth bread from the earth." He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body given in love for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he lifted a cup and gave thanks, praying, "Praise to you, Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine." Jesus gave it to them, saying, "This is a new covenant in my blood. Do this in remembrance of me." Since we are connected to God and are a part of God, we know we are loved, and we know that love lives within us. Since we are connected to one another as the body of Christ today, we know we are never alone. Together we embody the love of God for each other and for the world. Amen. I invite you to receive this blessing today, wherever you are, and those who are here to share it now, to hear these words given in love for you. Amen. Join with me now for the blessing in the last psalm. Trust that you are God's precious wildflowers, so bloom where you are planted for the glory of God. Wherever you find yourself, atop life's highest mountain peak or at the bottom of life's deepest, darkest valley, may we receive God's words like parched land drinks in rain, and sink our roots deep into the rich soil of our Creator's love. May we soak up the sunshine of Jesus' smile as we shine with the brightness of his relentless compassion. May we dance with joy in spirit breezes
and trust that Christ's resurrection power lives within us.
Lose yourself for the Lord in God's field of flowers. Bloom where you are planted for the glory of God. Amen.
Last song today is Control. Intentions, all my obsessions, I want to lay them all down in your hands. Only your love is vital, and though I'm not entitled, still you call me your child. You don't need me, but somehow you want me. Oh, how you love me. Somehow that frees me to take my hands off of my life and the way it should go. Oh, God, you don't need me, but somehow you want me. Oh, how you love me. Somehow that frees me to open my hands up and give you control. Control. I've had plans shattered and broken, things I have hoped in fall through my hands. You have plans to redeem and restore me. You're behind and before me.
Thank you so much for being a part of our worship today. It's so good to be together as we continue to abide with one another in God's love. Now, go with Christ and go as Christ to love and serve God's world.
Thanks be to God.